Oh, wow. So, good evening. Hi, everybody. Hello to the HIV/AIDS lecture series and to everyone who is here from the course especially and the general public. My name is Jordan Arsenal. I'm a member of the Cerro Sanzica Blood Union, which is a collective here in Montreal working to defend the needs and health of HIV and Hep C positive people and seroconcerned people. Alors, bienvenue à tous les membres de la communauté, surtout étudiants, la faculté, les bénévoles et les membres partenaires qui sont là avec nous ce soir. The Concordia HIV/AIDS Project takes as its mandate to reach a diverse community within and outside of Concordia University and in the greater public of Montreal. Its goals are to maintain a permanent space for interdisciplinary dialogue and research on HIV/AIDS for the region, to challenge the academy to confront the societal crisis engendered by HIV/AIDS and to expand its educational mission, and to develop awareness of social, scientific, and cultural aspects of the pandemic through community education, internal dialogue in the academy, social criticism, and the encouragement of volunteering, wink wink, and activism. To nurture the next generation of HIV/AIDS researchers, activists, and teachers within today's student population is its tie up with a bow goal of the many goals that this series aims to achieve. So before the lecture begins, one thank you is in order at least. The lecture series would like to thank Vive Healthcare, the principal sponsor that's making tonight possible. And for tonight's event, the lecture series has partnered primarily with the Concordia Department of Journalism, along with the support of numerous other departments who generously support the lecture series as a whole. So as is normally the case, the lecture, the speaker's presentation will last about an hour. It includes a short film tonight, which is exciting. We've allotted 30 minutes for questions after the talk, and during that time, you can raise your hand and one of the beloved volunteers will come and find you with a microphone, so you don't have to get out of your seat. Vous êtes libre de poser des questions après en français aussi, and you can ask questions in French or English. So starting at a route now, please turn off your cell phones for the duration of the presentation. And also, since, you know, the world is made of money, someone once said, please consider making a tax-deductible donation to the lecture series, as it relies a lot on all of those kinds of donations. Unless you want to make a donation in kind, you can also see Ian about that later, or make a donation at the front reception table. So given the generosity of the Department of Journalism in support of this lecture, I'm pleased to welcome Brian Gabriel, chair and professor here at the Concordia Department of Journalism, to introduce tonight's honored guest and speak to his significance in the field and in the community.
Thank you, Jordan. Well, bonsoir too, a good evening. It gives me great pleasure tonight to introduce Sean Strub for this, the second in the HIV lecture series this year. His talk tonight is Pause, Politics, Sex, and Survival. From the beginning of the plague, this crisis called AIDS, Sean Strub has been a frontline soldier in the toughest battle against it, and that is fighting ignorance, bigotry, and even hate against people living with HIV or AIDS. For many of us, it has been a war with two major fronts, the fight against the disease and the battle against homophobia. I haven't forgotten the time some 30 years ago, the time when Sean Strub found out he had AIDS, that back then, it was considered a death sentence when you were diagnosed HIV positive. And those in the gay community often discriminated against those who were HIV positive. There was no cure and there was no effective treatment. But Sean and his fellow soldiers, many sadly, whom did not survive, fought back against a government and a society that willingly, even knowingly, let its men and women die because they thought them untouchable and unworthy. He joined groups like ACT UP and even ran for Congress in 1990, the first person with HIV to do so. Then he began PAWS magazine. I remember very clearly the first time I ever saw the magazine. It was all glossy and upscale, very different from anything I'd ever seen about AIDS or HIV. Back then, the gay press seemed to be more focused on treatments and obituaries, but PAWS put a different spin on it all. Now the HIV community and those affected by AIDS had a voice, a strong, powerful journalistic voice that was about living and sharing and not about just death and dying. The magazine has been doing that for 20 years and remains the go-to source for the latest in the fight against the disease. Now, I cannot tell you everything that Sean has done to fight ignorance, bigotry, and unfortunately now apathy surrounding AIDS and HIV. As the executive director of the Zero Project, he works hard to make sure those living with HIV and AIDS are treated with respect and dignity. And he does not want us to forget ever that silence still equals death. And his new book, Body Counts, a memoir of politics, sex, AIDS, and survival, reveals a careless and callous world that gave him up and others for dead. He reminds us in that book that some of our best political friends today were quick to sell us out back then. Sean Strub is a filmmaker, an environmentalist, a play producer, a publisher, an editor, and that's just part of his resume. From my vantage point, of course, he's a great journalist. 22 years ago, in his book, Becoming a Man, the late poet, the American poet, Paul Monet, wondered about the straight community's indifference to those dying of AIDS. And he asked, why do they want us invisible? Sean Strub has been fighting against that every day, and his life work has been making it better for all of us, any of us, with HIV and AIDS. So please welcome Sean Strub.
I want to start with thanks to Tom and Ian for inviting me to be here today. The alternative would be in a very snowy Pennsylvania home alone because my partner works at a restaurant and it's Thanksgiving and he's obligated to be there today. So we're going to have Thanksgiving tomorrow night. And also Brian for that wonderful introduction and Jordan for emceeing and Ryan who is selling books back there. Very important function tonight, I hope. I'm not going to actually talk much about the book except for just a moment up front. And what I will say about the book is what my publisher told me a few weeks ago when the paperback came out. The hardcover came out in January. And I've had 50, 60 book events all over the country from gatherings of half a dozen people to some with many more. And they said, now, Sean, you really have worked hard promoting the book, and we've gotten lots of great coverage and lots of reviews. But with the paperback, we want you to think about talking about the book in a different way. Because you tend to talk about the policy and the politics, but your book is full of sex and celebrities and all sorts of things people are interested in. And if you talk more about the celebrities and the sex, you'd sell more books. So I'm now telling you there's sex and celebrities in the book, lots of adventures with Tennessee Williams and Andy Warhol and Gore Vidal and Yoko Ono and others. All my friends tell me the book is much funnier and more interesting than I am speaking out loud. So with that, what I do want to talk about tonight is stigma. And it's sort of the other side of the stigma coin, which is empowerment. And I joke that empowerment is, one of those words that is littered across every page of every grant application sitting at every foundation office out there. But people have a hard time actually defining it. I think like the US Supreme Court justice a few years ago when writing about pornography said he can't define it, but he knows it when he sees it. It's a little bit how I feel about empowerment. But what I do know is that what is most disempowering is stigma. And we're at this very peculiar point in the epidemic when treatment, antiretroviral treatment for HIV is incredibly effective, to the point that for those fortunate enough to have access to that treatment, it can render the illness a chronic manageable condition and not impede the life expectancy of a person with HIV. So how come if the treatment is so good, the stigma is so bad? Many of us with HIV think that HIV-related stigma is worse today than it has ever been, and getting worse. I'm one of the people who believe that. And people who don't have HIV often find that kind of startling. That, okay, well, it might be bad now, but I mean, look at the old days. People wouldn't touch you, and all the horrible things we've heard or seen in films and so on, or some of us experienced. And that is certainly true, and I'm going to talk about that. And I want to try and explain why I think stigma is worse today, maybe illustrate a few examples, particularly around the most extreme manifestation of stigma, which is criminalization, the inappropriate use, the wrongful use of someone's HIV status in a criminal prosecution, and a couple of ideas of what I think we should be doing about it. A few years ago, I was at a media briefing in Washington that the Kaiser Foundation holds every year. And it was on the results of a survey that they had conducted about HIV. They do this annually. And I forget what the major finding, the headline on the survey was, but the secondary finding that was the subhead on their press release was that stigma, AIDS-related, HIV-related stigma is lessening. And they got up and the researchers presented their findings, and they disclosed that as of that date, I think it was only 21 or 22% of people in the US believed one could get HIV from a drinking glass, and only 12% believed one could contract HIV from a toilet seat. And those were lower numbers than they had been before. They have progressively declined very slowly, and they're actually higher in the US than any other Western industrialized democracy. But they have declined, and that's obviously a good thing. Well, as they're sort of presenting this, I'm kind of bouncing in my seat. And when it got to the point where you could ask questions, I stood up and I challenged them. I said that what you're measuring is fear of casual contagion, certainly an element in stigma, but not in and of itself defining of stigma. Stigma, as experienced by the stigmatized, is, by those of us who actually have the virus, is more often about prejudgment, marginalization, othering, and of course it includes internalized stigma or self-stigmatization. Just the other day, our research director at the Sarah Project, Laurel Sprague, a woman living with HIV in Ann Arbor, pointed out that it's also important to remember that stigmatizing some people doesn't mean that everyone else receives neutral treatment. That stigmatizing some people, that those who are not part of the stigmatized group, and this is a function of the stigma that we experience, are treated as if they're more valuable and receive countless messages that they deserve better treatment than the stigmatized group. So to these researchers who announced that stigma was lessening, I suggested if they truly wanted to understand HIV-related stigma, they might start by surveying the stigmatized and asking them, instead of just measuring fear of casual contagion amongst the broader public and then making a pronouncement about stigma is lessening. I want to do a little bit of a then and now, contrasting the situation with stigma today to what it was like during the first 15 years of the epidemic, kind of using the introduction of protease combination therapy in the mid-90s as the dividing line. Back then, HIV stigma, in addition to the fear of casual contagion, which was certainly something that was very widespread, especially in the early years, it wasn't limited to bigots or to the ignorant. There was a time when we didn't know how the virus was spread. But stigma was fundamentally a proxy for old-fashioned garden variety homophobia. In 1981, at the dawn of the epidemic in the US, only 7% of the people in the US said that they knew someone who was gay or lesbian. Today, it's closer to 90%. AIDS is what introduced the broader society to gay people in the US. It isn't surprising that their response was shaped by the religious and moral framework with which they were most familiar. You mentioned when I ran for Congress in 1990 that I was the first openly HIV positive person to run for Congress in the US, and I'm proud of that. But at the time, it was no big deal. The drama and the news coverage and the attention was because I was gay. And at that time, the public in the US, perhaps especially in my congressional district, equated being gay with having AIDS. So that was a blip. That was barely written about. It was all about being gay. And the stigma, this homophobia, was sort of most extreme, or sort of, you know, see it in the media, with religious and conservatives and you know, the political right wing, you know, Reverend Jerry Falwell and Pat Buchanan and Pat Robertson and others, who would say hateful things about people with AIDS. But that wasn't a new experience for gay men. You know, that didn't hurt. We already knew they hated us. It didn't hurt in the same way. We already knew they hated us. That was sort of external from people who were already our enemies, and they were just saying more awful things about us. Many of us had come out and found some measure of protection with each other and within a queer community that at that time accepted the epidemic as both an urgent priority and a collective responsibility. When someone was diagnosed, they were encircled with love from a community that said to them, "We will get through this together." Yet today, the LGBT community's engagement with the epidemic, with some notable exceptions, but overall, it's almost entirely gone. We made it so possible for people to come out that the mass of people who came out reflected the values of middle America as well. And so our priorities in the gay movement in the US moved towards marriage equality and military service and things like that. Those of us with the virus became increasingly at the edges. And no longer does the community accept the epidemic as a collective responsibility. Certainly there's not the wide array of services and support that emanated from the queer community as there once was. And when a gay man is diagnosed today, he is generally on his own, without the breadth of social, emotional, and other support that was the hallmark of the community's response in the early years, and very often without even the support of his own social circle and friends. I think a case can be made that a gay man coming out today about having HIV amongst his group, his social circle, goes through more of a dramatic change and transition in those relationships than he might have years ago. And the stigma that most gay men face today, that is the most painful and most damaging and even cruel, isn't that which is externally imposed by religious conservatives out on the outside. It is that which is inflicted on them by other gay men within their other communities, within their own community. And just as we learned in the 1980s and showed to the world how loving and extraordinary this queer community could be in a way that was so exemplary. It should be a model for every community responding to needs. We learned that about our community. We showed that to the world then. And sadly, today, we're also learning about a very ugly side of our community that can be cruel and indifferent. Euphemisms like clean, for someone who's HIV negative, or just as often, someone who in truth does not know their HIV status, have entered the vernacular, clearly indicting those of us with HIV as dirty. That stigmatization from other gay men, in conjunction with the institutionalized LGBT community's abandonment of the epidemic, is toxic. And of course, it isn't just gay men who report the most intrusive and damaging stigma today is that which comes from closest to their homes. Most people with HIV I know report that the most painful stigma they experience does come from their communities, their families, the clinics where they receive services, the institutions where they are incarcerated or housed. So there's this shift of stigma from a specific fear of casual contagion and generalized disparagement of sexual minorities and people who use drugs by those already known to be their enemies, to a more amorphous marginalization and demonization of the HIV-positive individual by individuals with whom they must interact every day. Today, when someone discloses their HIV-positive status, they are more likely to be judged, more likely to have their moral worth questioned. Those testing positive are frequently blamed for their infection, and unkind and stigmatizing assumptions are made about their sexual or other behaviors. We know stigma is detrimental to the health of the stigmatized. It gets in the way of accessing treatment, and it can cut off emotional support from families, friends, and communities. And it's often internalized by the stigmatized, translating into a self-shaming that can fuel self-destructive behaviors and thought patterns. But it isn't just an individual burden, because it's also damaging to public health. Stigma remains the single biggest obstacle to getting people at risk tested for HIV. Yet we know that most new HIV infections in the US are transmitted by people who have HIV and do not know it. There are roughly 850 or 900,000 people in the US who have HIV and know it, and there are 200,000 or 300,000 who have HIV and do not know it. A majority of the new infections come from those who do not know it. Once people are tested, they pose less risk to others in terms of their sexual behaviors and risk of transmitting HIV. The stigma isn't driven only by ignorance and intolerance or judgment we face in individual interactions. There are also systemic drivers, like how we're viewed and treated by the public health and criminal justice systems or depicted in the media. Up until life-saving treatment was introduced in the mid-90s, regardless of whatever religious or moral judgment someone might make about homosexuality or people who use drugs or engage in sex work or whatever, all but the very coldest of human hearts had some measure of compassion for those with the virus. The popular perception was that we were going to die horrific deaths very soon, possibly in a painful manner. And of course, hundreds of thousands did. But treatment profoundly changed what it means to have HIV. And not long after protease therapy was introduced, the public perception of people with HIV began to change as well. Where once we were seen through the expectation of our impending death, we began to be seen through the likelihood of our potential survival. While we were dying, we were seen as victims rather than as a threat, especially as our emaciated bodies, repeated illnesses, and purple Kaposi sarcoma lesions made us easy to identify and avoid. But our renewed health and survival in the wake of effective treatment not only made it more difficult to recognize us, but it also inaugurated a shift in the public's perception from viewing us through the likelihood of our early deaths to viewing us through that survival, And that survival and living longer meant we would be around longer to infect others. So we started to become defined, especially by the public health and criminal justice system, as inherently dangerous, a problem population, potential infectors, viral vectors. So much so that we needed to be tracked down, tested, identified, tagged, reported, listed, monitored, regulated, and ultimately criminalized. It's no coincidence that the same time in the mid-90s, when this shift in perception was taking place, was when the US government finally was able to implement mandatory names reporting to facilitate the control and monitoring of people with HIV, and began to phase out anonymous testing in favor of so-called confidential testing, which meant that your name was required by law to be reported to a state list. It's also when a new round of HIV criminalization statutes were passed. In the US, unlike in Canada, every state criminal statutes are different, and about two-thirds of the states in the US have HIV-specific statutes that only apply to people with HIV, creating law around an immutable characteristic, when most people don't think it's a great idea to create laws around other immutable characteristics, whether it's gender, sexual orientation, race, physical ability or disability, or your genetic makeup. Most people think it's not a great idea to make laws different for different parts of the population based on those characteristics, but we are doing it right now in the US, creating a viral underclass in the law, a segment of society with rights inferior to others. And it's stigma that has driven the vitriol against people with HIV that's resulted in these coercive public and discriminatory public health and criminal laws and policies that threaten fundamental human rights, fail to respect individual autonomy. People with HIV are on the forefront of an erosion of the respect for autonomy for people within the healthcare system. In the early years of the epidemic, those testing positive were told that life-changing news only after they had received extensive pre- and post-test counseling. And they were very often, if not usually, told, don't disclose your HIV-positive status to anybody else. Keep this a secret until you have created a supportive network around yourself to be able to deal with the consequences of disclosure. That couldn't be more different today. People get tested routinely, sometimes even without their knowledge, and they receive little or no pre- or post-test counseling. And when they receive a positive test result, they're bounced out onto the sidewalk and expected to go home and start disclosing immediately. And if they don't, they risk arrest and imprisonment, regardless of whether or not they ever posed a risk to another person. In the earlier years of the epidemic, the overwhelming likelihood of someone with HIV inevitably becoming sick and becoming apparent that this person was ill informed the disclosure dynamic. Most people with HIV at a certain point thought at some point their friends and family, they were going to know. And that helped many of them choose to disclose. Today, someone with healthcare access, people of privilege who test positive, can choose to keep it a secret forever. And many do, rendering a big part of the community of people with HIV invisible. The shame that's intertwined with secrecy perpetuates our isolation and is an obstacle to creating the solidarity that we need to combat stigma. And it's put people with HIV in a Kafkaesque nightmare with no safe out, because there are such significant risks in disclosing one's HIV status. It sometimes forces a choice between banishment and punishment. Two women were murdered in the last 18 months in separate incidents in Texas after disclosing their HIV positive status to their boyfriends. Partner violence in the wake of HIV disclosure is a common occurrence. and if someone were to measure it, I suspect they would find it to be increasing. In September of 2012, Cicely Bolden told Anthony Dunn that she had HIV. He stabbed her to death, and he told the police, "She was killing me, so I killed her." Just a few months ago, 30-year-old Alicia Henson performed oral sex on Justin Welch, and when he learned she had HIV, he strangled her. In addition to partner violence, another very important reason why women in particular are reluctant to disclose is because it so often puts at risk the custody of their children, or they fear getting kicked out of their housing. When someone's HIV positive status becomes known, we risk losing housing, employment, support from family and friends, and social standing in our communities. And in theory, there are legal protections in place for housing and employment and so on. But in the real world, most people who are suffering from that kind of discrimination and injustice, they don't have access to the legal system in order to protect their rights. Now, of course, disclosure in the earlier years of the epidemic could carry terrible ramifications as well. But those ramifications were mitigated by the compassion and sympathy extended to those who had HIV, as well as by an amazingly supportive and loving community that came to our side, led by the LGBT community, but encompassing the network of service providers that we created. Even pop culture, with AIDS having become a popular cause, helped shape how we were treated. So where did that go? That very best face of our community, that incredible expression of love and compassion, people who turned their lives upside down to care for a neighbor who was ill, who maybe they didn't even know very well before that person became ill. Today, in much of the world, the defining response to the epidemic isn't one of compassion, but it's a criminalization. And every person, especially in the US and Canada, as I'm sure most of you know, every person with HIV is just one disgruntled ex-partner away from finding themselves in a courtroom. I'm going to show about a 7-minute film that I made a couple years ago about HIV criminalization, which I think will help illustrate this point.
I was trying to figure out what's right and what's wrong. A law, you know, something is against the law, then it's telling society that that is unacceptable, that's bad behavior. And I think the severity of that punishment tells you how bad you are as a person. You know, you're a Class B felon, lifetime sex offender. You are a very, very, very bad person. You did a very, very, very bad thing. And so that's just, you know, programmed into you, and, you know, you go through the correctional system and everyone's telling you the same thing, and you're just like, I'm a very bad person, very bad person.
Today in court, Roush was charged with another count of first-degree assault. The special statute covers passing on AIDS or poisoning someone with a destructive substance.
Prosecutor asked that another charge, unlawful use of a harmful device, in this case, Allen's HIV status, be added. That's a 15-year felony. The judge agreed.
They learned that Chambers is HIV positive. Fort Mill police upped the charge from simple assault to assault and battery with intent to kill.
More serious charges were added because the defendant is HIV positive.
Because the suspect has HIV, he's facing some unusually serious charges.
Authorities, though, still consider him a danger as long as he can infect others.
HIV, gay, sex, you know, all wrapped into one. It's just like it's a gift on a platter. Whatever the facts are, whatever the science is, whatever, it does not matter.
I come home one day and, you know, you just kind of get a feel, you know, someone's been in your apartment or your home. And I looked on the counter and I saw a document, which was a search warrant. left by the sex crime detective. They showed up to arrest me, and they arrested me at work.
So me getting HIV, it was like a shock. It was just like, how did I get this? How did it hit the Howell's house? How did it hit here? I'm a church girl. My dad's a pastor. He's still a pastor. So we grew up in church. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, all day long. Being a good wife, and I did the right thing, and because of an affair that happened in my marriage by my spouse at the time, that's how I got it. He looked at me just like a man who was, he looked at me just as if I was negative, just like I'm normal. How do I even disclose my status? How do I do this? How do I get those words out of my mouth, HIV? I was afraid of how he was going to look at me. I was afraid that how he would judge me. And the only thing I could say is, you need to get a condom. I had so many thoughts going on in my head while I was sitting in court. Like, you know, what if I walk out and so many people walking around calling me the monster? What if I get labeled a sex offender? What if they take my kids away from me? If convicted, I was looking at 8 to 12 years. And
if convicted, then the sentence would be anywhere from 0 to 10 years.
The full 25 years.
The Attorney General is arguing William should be held indefinitely under a newly enacted civil confinement law.
New York State wants to find another way to keep him behind bars permanently.
I felt like I went out and killed a whole bunch of people. They made me feel like that.
I mean, one thing I always told myself, and I've shared with others, that I would never end up at a police station. I would never go to jail because I felt like I was always a law-abiding citizen. My mother had me at a very young age, 12 when she conceived me and 13 when she had me. Yeah. So I always just say that I'm before my time because she had me so young. So I was a straight-A student growing up and just, you know, very successful. But here, the very thing that I said would never happen to me or that I would find myself in is the very thing that was happening to me.
I had to register as a sex offender every 3 months versus certain pedophiles and other, you know, sexual crimes. It's like 6 months. I mean, I was like very dangerous in crimes. Couldn't be around minors without being supervised by their parents. To wear a GPS ankle bracelet and be monitored 24 hours a day. No alcohol in the house, I could not drink, I had to be home by midnight, I couldn't watch pornography at all. They could ask me to bring my computer in at any time to interrogate it. I couldn't be on any social networking, not even Facebook. That's where pictures of my nieces and nephews are. I had to go through all these psychological tests to take some phallometric assessment test to see what really stimulates me sexually, which I think has something to do with putting a device on my penis. Holograph tests. Every 6 months for the rest of my life, you're going to hook me up to this machine. You're going to ask me these same inane questions. I can't live like that. And I can't live under that probation system that is so suffocating and, you know, just cruel.
A warning from a woman infected with
the arrest
HIV
of an HIV positive prostitute
warning
in
the public
St. Louis
tonight about this
for hiding
man.
His HIV positive status at swinger
and the man called the HIV predator will make his
so-called
case
HIV predator with someone with
dozens,
intent to kill
they are
they don't
calling picture. Him a threat to society.
The media, the military courts, whatever, they could call me whatever they wanted to call me, but I knew I wasn't those names that they were calling me. I just was a human being trying to, you know, just wanted to fit in, just wanted to be loved, but it seemed like that three-letter word, HIV, just had me stuck. I didn't realize the stigma on HIV and AIDS until I was diagnosed. Many people not wanting to go get tested, you know, because they're afraid that if tested positive, if they had unprotected sex with someone and someone tries to get them in trouble.
Him reacting, the way he reacted is the way that is the reason why most people are afraid to disclose because of the fear and because of the stigma that comes from it.
HIV criminalization needs to be changed.
You know, my stepfather is a promise-keeping Baptist. You know, he is salt of the earth, and veterinarian, small town, and I told him this stuff, and he's just like, that is horse shit.
But what I've done since then is just devoted myself to advocacy, to volunteering, to get involved and learning more about HIV and AIDS, and with hopes that that could open a door for me, because obviously this is my life now.
The media, as you saw in the film, was also complicit in this stigma. Up until the mid-90s, there was a steady stream of human interest stories, feature coverage, of people with HIV who were valiantly and courageously leading their lives, raising their children, making their art, starting businesses, going to school, just going about their lives, despite having this very serious health challenge. But as we became redefined in the 90s, from tragic victims to an inherent threat, the media led the charge. And today, when a person with HIV is covered in the media, it's far more likely to be in a criminal context, as an AIDS monster or an AIDS predator. And just as an aside, at the Sarah Project, we've identified more than 1,300 instances when charges have been filed under HIV-specific statutes. And it isn't just the HIV-specific statutes for one's HIV status can be used inappropriately, but under just the HIV-specific statutes, 1,300 times we found charges were filed. HIV transmission is a factor in a very tiny percentage of them, certainly less than 10%, probably less than 5%, possibly less than 2%. So it's not about transmission. It's not about whether or not there is even a risk of transmission. In most cases, it boils down to simply whether or not the person with HIV is able to disclose that they had, to prove that they had disclosed that status to their partner before becoming intimate. So the challenge around stigma that most people see is thinking about stigmatizers as a problem, and how do we educate the stigmatizers, whether they're individuals or institutions. Telling them that stigma is bad, making them aware of the real facts about the routes, risks, and consequences of exposure to or transmission to HIV. And with the right facts and the right education, the thinking goes, they'll stop stigmatizing. And there have been probably hundreds of millions of dollars spent on well-meaning media campaigns to try and do this. Social marketing campaigns that assault us with billboards and bus ads and everything else, brochures and advertising, exhorting act against AIDS, HIV stigma scars, rise up to HIV, HIV equals, start talking, stop HIV, take charge, take the test. We can stop HIV one conversation at a time, and similar messages. Almost always under the rubric of combating stigma. And I don't want to condemn all of these campaigns. Some of them I actually think are helpful. But for the most part, I don't think they're an effective way to combat stigma, and in some cases, they can actually increase stigma. You can raise awareness of HIV and raise stigma at the same time. A lot of the HIV testing campaigns are pretty skilled at doing that. So if I don't think those social marketing campaigns are so effective, what do I think would be successful? And I think the answer is not anything innovative or new. It's really found in how we responded to the epidemic in the earlier years. You know, in 1986, the New York Times gave prominent space to William F. Buckley, the legendary sort of icon of the American intellectual right, to present his proposal for tattooing people with HIV. This was not a fringe person. This was someone who was thought of as one of the most important intellects of the right wing. Tattoo people with HIVs on their arms to, quote, protect common needle users, and on their buttocks to, quote, prevent the victimization of other homosexuals, as well as to require women to be sterilized before allowing them to marry a man with HIV. Buckley also disputed the scientific consensus that the virus was not transmitted casually, and he raised the prospect of public identification and potentially more drastic segregation measures. This wasn't in the first days. This was 5 years after the epidemic was recognized, 2 years after the virus was discovered, and way past the time when it was known definitively that HIV was not transmitted casually. And around the same time, anti-gay political activists in California qualified an initiative on the ballot, a public referendum in California, called Proposition 64, that would have quarantined people with HIV. Similar measures were under consideration in other states and certainly would have been pursued had the California proposal passed. Well, the quarantine measure, despite being ahead in the polls for part of the year, it didn't pass, and Buckley's proposals were not implemented. And the reason was that we fought back against stigma with just as much passion and as just as much of a priority as we fought the virus. They weren't indistinguishable. Yes. The reaction to Buckley's column was swift and effective. There was a huge outcry. Thousands attended demonstrations. When Patricia Buckley, his wife, joined the benefit committee for a fancy AIDS fundraiser, you probably remember this, sir, she wouldn't disavow her husband's comments. And yet here she's on the benefit committee for this big AIDS benefit. So we protested loudly. We exposed her hypocrisy and embarrassed them both. The California initiative required a year-long effort and hundreds of thousands of dollars and thousands of volunteers to defeat it. So stigma isn't just about ignorance. It's always been driven in significant measure by sophisticated voices and interests that have made careers and empires out of oppressing the least franchised among us and exploiting mass fear. And specifically with the epidemic, there is what I call an arrogance of the well, who believe it's the rest of society's responsibility to protect their health, protect their HIV negative status. But back then, we fought so hard. We didn't ever let stigma go unaddressed. We rallied supporters, we took to the streets, pressured the media, organized politically. One of the very first AIDS organizations was GLAAD, the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation. You know, now I don't know, $10 or $12 million a year organization that fights for better depictions of queer people in the media or something. GLAAD was formed by Vita Russo and Marcia Pally and Daryl Yates Frist specifically to combat the stigmatizing coverage in the New York Post of people with AIDS. And every AIDS organization, because back then we had created these organizations, you know, the boards of directors were comprised of people with HIV and our partners and our very closest friends. You know, they didn't ever have a board dinner where they talked about them referring to the clients, because it was this peer-to-peer model that we pioneered. It was very different from the existing service delivery system, which was more of a benefactor-victim model. And every one of those AIDS organizations, large or small, responded to stigma. They had a responsibility to be a public voice when things in their community came up. Yet today, most of them are silent on these issues. They say, well, we provide services. We leave the politics and the advocacy to someone else. GLAAD moved on to other issues. For many years, they did absolutely nothing on HIV at all. We're hopeful that might now be starting to change. We'll see. Not very long ago, a city commissioner in Portland, Oregon, ordered at great expense the draining of an 8 million gallon outdoor reservoir that supplied the city's water system. The reason was because a security camera had filmed a teenage kid urinating in the reservoir. Now, this is an outdoor reservoir. that occasionally they drag out carcasses of deer and, you know, everything else. But the commissioner was concerned that the boy's urine might transmit HIV, and he ordered it drained. That same year, a state legislator in Montana testified before a legislative committee that was considering repeal of the state's capital punishment statute. And this legislator, in the video of her testimony is online, actually, it's on YouTube, this legislator testified, we must keep the capital punishment statute because there are new ways to kill people. And people with AIDS in the state prison, they smear their saliva or their feces on little paper airplanes and throw them at the guards to try and infect them. Now, those are pretty absurd examples, and they were reported in the media in those communities. Neither one of them reached any kind of national attention, and there was almost no response to them. AIDS organizations in both places indicated they were concerned about speaking out for what it might, how it might affect their funding. They were politically reliant. They were trying to keep their doors open, as so many of these organizations are, with fewer and fewer funds. And the only press release, the only public comment against them, were releases that a small group of us with HIV through GNP Plus, which is the global network of people living with HIV, the North American regional affiliate, which is an unstaffed, unfunded Canadian-US group, we put out a little press release, and but nothing from GLAAD, nothing from AIDS Inc. There are no media watchdogs or civil liberties groups or public health organizations who take on the responsibility of calling out this kind of stigmatizing bigotry. AIDS Inc. is much more comfortable combating stigma with feel-good social marketing campaigns than calling out the perpetrators and purveyors of stigma. And so what is the public supposed to think about the risk we pose, people with HIV pose, when elected officials or law enforcement or public health officials wildly overreact or act from ignorance or fear and don't get challenged, not even in the mildest way sometimes? In the film, you saw what Nick Rhodes, Monique Murray, and Robert Suttle went through, even though none of them were accused of transmitting HIV. But there are only three of many who've been prosecuted. Right now in Texas, Willie Campbell is serving a 35-year sentence for spitting at someone. David Plunkett served more than 6 years in a New York state prison for spitting at someone. Now, New York and Texas do not have these HIV-specific statutes, but under regular criminal statutes, prosecutors charge them with much more serious felonies because they had HIV. Now, spitting is not very attractive behavior. You know, we don't want people going around spitting at other people, and it's probably appropriate for the state to step in and try and discourage that. But proportionality is a pretty fundamental concept of justice that seems to have been lost there. And then, you know, and by the way, these two men in Texas who killed their girlfriends, you know, you can't excuse that behavior, but the state has to take some responsibility. If their state, their elected officials, their media is putting people in prison for 35 years for spitting, well, those people with HIV must be incredibly dangerous. You know, it's entirely possible that they were truly thought that their lives had been endangered or were about to end. You know, that's obviously not an excuse for killing someone, but it does sort of indict something broader than those individuals. Tiffany Moore, this woman we've been working with the last couple of years, who was convicted on prostitution charges in Tennessee. But Tennessee has a statute of sentencing enhancement. And so if you're convicted on prostitution charges and you have HIV, it's a much, much more serious sentence. A member of our board of directors of CERL, a man named Kerry Thomas, who is right now 6 years into a 30-year sentence in Idaho for not disclosing. I went out to Idaho to interview Kerry, to videotape him. There's on our CERL website, we have a number of short video interviews with people who've been prosecuted. And everyone agreed, prosecutor and his accuser agreed, that he always used a condom that he had an undetectable viral load. And while I was out in Boise, I met people who said, his partner was a woman, he said she knew he was positive because they had talked to her about it. They worked in the same office. And when Carrie was hired, a memo was circulated about what to do in the case of a biohazard. It didn't name him, but the office gossip. Everybody knew why it was being circulated. He had been in the newspapers in Boise, Idaho, as a person with HIV on the front page of the paper. But so often in these cases, the evidence doesn't matter, and the science certainly doesn't matter. And a huge number of them are racially driven. Kerry Thomas is an African-American man. He's a Muslim, and his accuser was a white woman. And in addition to getting prosecuted, all these cases I've mentioned have something else in common, which was that there was very little community outcry from the AIDS establishment or any kind of organized support for them during their prosecution and conviction. So I think we not only need to respond in the media, respond to these stigmatizing, have sort of like a rapid response team to not let those things go unchallenged, you know, to make it hurt for people who say these incredibly stupid and damaging things, but we also need to provide legal resources and support for the people who are suffering at this most extreme end of stigma, getting charged. But until recently, in the US more often, if news coverage of someone who was charged for non-disclosure included a comment from a local AIDS organization, it was more typically supportive of the prosecution. Or it was something like, well, there are a few bad apples in every barrel, or something like that. So the infrastructure, the service infrastructure that we created had become, in many cases, to be actually actively working against us. But even if we do those two things, aggressively respond to stigma and provide support to those criminalized, in the end, we won't defeat stigma until, unless we empower the stigmatized, supporting the efforts of people with HIV to gain agency and overcome stigma's debilitating effects on our lives and on all of society. This goes back to my sort of fundamental thought about stigma, was forget about the stigmatizers, focus on the stigmatized. And this is where something else is different today from earlier years in the epidemic. And by the way, I'm conscious of, I'm saying all these things in Montreal, which is sort of a nexus of some of the most vibrant and important AIDS activism underway on this continent right now. So many of the exceptions that come to mind around various things, actually there are such exceptions here in Montreal. But something else that's different is that in the earlier years of the epidemic, when someone tested positive, they were almost always connected to some local network of people with HIV, a body positive or being alive or living positively or people with AIDS coalition or whatever. These were organizations or informal networks that were created, controlled, and led by people with HIV. And it's in those organizations and networks where someone newly diagnosed found a positive, supportive environment. That's where they learned how to disclose, was discussing their status with other people with HIV. And it's in those organizations and networks where we, people with HIV, were able to create our own agenda, able to select and put forth our own leadership. It's where we built political power, where we became a community, learned how to fight back. And back then, we did that with the support of the broader community. We did that with the support of the AIDS infrastructure and the AIDS organizations and all sorts of AIDS advocates. But in the wake of effective treatment, the funding for those networks in the US almost entirely evaporated. And the service providers, even the ones that weren't funded, but that were sort of housed within the structure of one of the service providers that was supportive in providing space and some facilitation or administration of it, they didn't find those networks as important. And in many cases, they found those networks to be a problem. And then we had a whole new class of people with HIV who became the selected representatives of our community by other interests. Not to denigrate anyone with HIV who's working in these agencies, we need them. But there's a fundamental difference between the leadership that the community selects and the leadership that the industry selects. And so we need, and as these networks faded, so too did the voice of people with HIV. And at the same time that these other stigmatizing factors were happening. So we need these networks today more than ever, and we need them to speak for specific voices. The SARO project started with creating a network of people who have been criminalized. Robert and Monique and Nick most prominently amongst them. Now it's about 35 people. Coming together for support, to share their experiences, talk about what is important, and then a number of people sort of came out of that network to become leaders of it and to become advocates. Robert Suttle is the associate director of the SARO project. Nick Rhodes was very involved in the effort in Iowa, which I'll talk to you about in a minute. Monique Moray founded you're a pastor too, you just don't call yourself that. She founded an HIV testing and drop-in center in Holly Hills, South Carolina, 45 miles away from the nearest HIV services. So I tell her she has her own congregation. It was through the networks that enable us to fight against those who scapegoat us, fire us from our jobs, evict us from our homes, separate us from our loved ones, our community, and our peers. And it's through these networks where we can do that again. There's a new network of transgender women with HIV in the US that is just getting started. SARO itself is a national network of people with HIV. We've started a small network of people who are incarcerated or formerly incarcerated with HIV. There's a new network for people who are immigrants with HIV that's just in the process of organizing right now. Because when there is a network and a group of people who define that network, you then have a place to go to hear from that specific community. And you get a very different message than if some panel or agency is going out and picking who they want to speak for that community. As long as we allow people with HIV to be treated as less than, as long as we allow the right of people with HIV to sexual intimacy, to be seen as secondary or unimportant, as long as we buy into the shame, as long as we allow stigma to go unchallenged, then we'll continue to be stigmatized. Supporting people with HIV in these networks to produce that leadership and that agenda and that voice is, I think, the single biggest missing piece in addressing stigma today. We have to have the ability to choose our own representatives and have those voices heard, to devise our own strategies, whether it's dealing with the media or public officials or service providers. We have to be involved at every level of decision-making, especially the boards of directors of provider organizations. That's the only path we have to having any sort of voice and control of our community's future. And you know, I know a lot of your students are very young, and you think about the early days of AIDS activism, and what generally comes to mind first for people is ACT UP and the very theatrical street demonstrations that were very much an important part of my life. But you know, that didn't begin until 1987, and there was a chapter of AIDS activism that preceded that, that in many ways is almost more important. I don't want to say more important, but it's been neglected, and it's the chapter we need to revisit and recreate today. And that was when people with HIV, and I'm old-fashioned, I keep saying people with AIDS because that's what we said back then, got together. We focused on each other. We were very internally focused. It was a do-it-yourself movement. We created this iconic document, The Denver Principles, was written in 1983 that codifies these principles of self-empowerment. And from that, we created not only this sort of parallel network of service delivery structures, all the big AIDS service organizations today, or almost all of them, were created originally as grassroots peer-to-peer community groups. We created our own research organizations. We created buyers clubs. And the movie is lovely, and Matthew McConaughey is cute, but that's not reflective of the buyers club movement. It's reflective of the Dallas thing. Although some friends and I do like to say that we are mentioned in Dallas Buyers Club, because at one point he's asked where he got the idea to start a buyers club, and he said, a bunch of faggots in New York did it. We created our own media. We weren't looking externally. We were looking to each other to create community and be each other's experts and support. And then in 1987, when the very first trickle of treatment started to come out, the activism became much more focused on treatment and on expediting that process. It was an activism that saved my life. I wouldn't be here. But it wasn't focused on people with HIV. It was focused externally on the institutions of power that hadn't been responding and trying to get them to respond. So I think that distinction is important to understand. There's actually a Canadian man who teaches maybe at McGill who wrote a book, and I can't, James Gillette, I think his name is, who wrote a book on the history of the people with AIDS movement or the self-empowerment movement in North America. That is, it's not very big, but it is absolutely excellent. I buy and give it away all the time. That really details this sort of pre-ACT UP history that I think is so important and that I think we need to revisit today. And I do have to say that that as bleak as this sometimes seems, it's also important to remind ourselves how change can happen, even when people think it's impossible. 5 or 6 years ago, when I first started organizing around criminalization work, there was very, very few people who took it seriously. The AIDS organizations, we ultimately ended up forming CERO because we couldn't get the organizations that should have been doing this to do what we felt was necessary. One member of the U.S. Senate, who I happened to have an opportunity to spend some time on, who was sort of sympathetic, and I'm explaining this, and he goes, he says, you know, I totally agree with you. He says, you're going to get nowhere. He says, you're one of those lost cause people. He says, you'll spend your whole life fighting for a lost cause, you'll never make it anywhere. That was the popular perception about changing these statutes. People saw it in partisan terms. Oh, we'll never get anything. And yet, change can happen. In Iowa, which happens to be where I'm from, it is a conservative rural state, as most of you probably know. We now have, Joni Ernst in the U.S. Senate, and Chuck Grassley, and Steve King is a member of the House. Ernst and King are probably, if you made anybody's list of the six looniest members of Congress, we've got a third of them. Yet in Iowa, we changed the statute. It was repealed earlier this year. Republican governor, Republicans control the state house, the Democrats control the Senate. And we did so because a network of people with HIV got together about 5 years ago and went to work on this and reached out, educated their communities, built a coalition over the time, framed the issue in public health terms, got the State Department of Public Health engaged. Iowa is a late testing state, and I know that's a problem in parts of Canada. About half the people getting diagnosed with HIV in Iowa were diagnosed in an emergency room when they were already sick. And the State Department of Public Health was looking to what are the obstacles to getting people tested. And Iowa had filed charges against about 1% of the people with HIV in the state under their HIV-specific statute. And they realized that this statute was discouraging people from getting tested. We had a criminalization conference in Iowa at Grinnell College in June. It happened to coincide with when the governor signed the change in the law. And two men in Iowa who were convicted, Nick Rhodes was one of them, the other was a young man from Waterloo named Donald Bogardis, were at a reception we had kind of celebrating this during the conference. And the state senator who sponsored the bill Nick and Donald both were wearing ankle monitoring bracelets. They had to wear 24 hours a day as registered sex offenders. And the bill that was signed did not overturn their convictions, but it did decouple the conviction from sex offender registration. So in a surprise, the state senator from Des Moines, Matt McCoy, who sponsored the bill, came to the reception with a great big pair of bolt cutters. And in front of this group, called them up and, surprise, cut the ankle bracelets off of them. One of the most moving moments of my life. And it was a really a living testament to what can be accomplished when we work together and we put people with HIV at the center of the response and provide the support necessary to amplify our voice. In his tribute, I weave this in almost every time I talk because I just love the words. In his tribute to South African hero, to Stephen Biko, Peter Gabriel wrote, "You can blow out a candle, but you can't blow out a fire. Once the flames begin to catch, the wind will blow it higher." This movement for self-empowerment of people with HIV, this Denver Principles document that was written in 1983, that was the beginning of a fire. It was the first time in the history of humanity when people who shared a disease organized politically to assert their right to a voice in the policymaking that would so profoundly affect their lives. It was later recodified by UNAIDS under the GPA-MIPA principles, the greater involvement of people with HIV and AIDS and meaningful involvement of people with HIV and AIDS. But even more important, it was the Denver Principles cited in a World Health Organization, something called the Ottawa Declaration, 1986, I think it was. But it's become a model for organizing and service delivery in all sorts of other disease states as well, all around the world, not just in HIV. There's a lot of activism around this in people with various mental health conditions. So that was a fire that was started in 1983, and it has flickered over the years, sometimes been stronger, sometimes less so. I like to think that it is on the upsurge right now, and if all of us can blow a little bit in its direction, because we've all got the breath to be able to do that, we can blow it higher. Thanks very much.
Hi, everybody. Well, I'm Sean Strub. Thank you so much for that incredibly perceptive slicing through, I think, a lot of layers of history that have brought us to the point, and recent history, too, that have brought us to the point where we are at now, where for people who aren't living with HIV, it might, you might be led to believe that we aren't living in a brutal surveillance state. Or if you're not, for instance, a person of color, you might think that we're not living in a brutal surveillance state. But it's a reminder that there are forces that were at work in the 80s that you were opposing that have actually gotten stronger. Surveillance, scapegoating, and criminalization have gotten stronger. And I think there's a lot of people who could have predicted that. Knowing the way that our political organization has gone. The other thing that I definitely think is awesome that you're bringing up now, and I think perhaps the next lecture in the series might also address, is the greater involvement of people with HIV and AIDS and this need to return to the source, in a way, of where this power that they wanted to unleash was to come from. And certainly the institutionalization of our nonprofits is something that people have pointed to and that we've seen certainly around criminalization, as you said, has not played in our favor to have, those kinds of non-POS people running those organizations. So I think,
Oh,
it's true. The traitors within.
It's more about not having the sort of organized, structured voice of people with HIV supported by other people with HIV that rise up through the networks.
Because that brings up, I mean, we're going to definitely go to questions really soon, but it brings up another, another fascinating story within the story is that in a way you're saying that the heightened level of crisis created a heightened level of community, and that in the kind of, you know, beige of 1996 and the period where, and afterwards, and the kind of taupe era in which I contracted HIV in 2005-2006, this was not an era where people were flocking to help you. You just had a bunch of people asking you, how did you get that in the first place? Don't you know better? So I think that's I think a point that maybe other people have questions about, and we should probably go to those questions now. Sorry.
Just raise your hand.
Really? I'm going to be the first one again. but it's really interesting because that you showed the video, because being like post-age generation activist, being HIV negative too, like it's always like I get all the questions from all people around me, and at some point I have the AIDS stigma at some point, like, you know, dating guys and dating I'm HIV positive, because how would you do prevention work and stuff? And like in your narrative, there is this tension between the nostalgia of the early days and the now. What should we do now? What is the problem with the model, and what is the problem with the institution? And I think one of the fucked up things, we are in a fucked up system right now. And there are the two tensions between the notion of AIDS exceptionalism on one side and the AIDS normalization on the other side. And like one of the main thing that I think we are not addressing when we're thinking about like AIDS, TB or Ebola. And like, I work for a Health and Safety Commission of Quebec, which is like CORCACOM socialized, you know, our system here. But I've worked extensively with nurses, elderly, and the way they see HIV, and like from nurses and doctors I've dated too, there is a different system that works there. You know, we have our HIV knowledge, we have the public health framework, but, you know, just look at the coverage of Ebola. There's this different system of knowledge of how people perceive health, disease, sickness. And this is the system that's ongoing. And like one of the theses that's there, I think we should be addressing, is like, I think it's more that is influencing law, political power to use example like AIDS to be criminalizing people and doing this ongoing and ongoing system where it's like you have the healthy and the unhealthy, and therefore in a society we should put away people that are unhealthy. So I would be interested to know more what you think of that, like beyond AIDS knowledge, like what's going on there.
Okay, so it sounds like a question about health fascism.
Well, I mean, I think this is manifesting in all sorts of different disease states. We're really seeing a securitization of disease. And, you know, it seems like we're in a system where the highest and most important value of a person with HIV to the system is as a consumer of pharmaceutical products. And the incentives in the system in many ways seem to further that rather than whether it's prevention or rather than dealing with the myriad issues that make people vulnerable for HIV or other kinds of health conditions. So mostly I'm just sort of, you know, I agree with you. I don't know that I have any especially innovative insight around that. You know, I don't think that talking about the early days, I don't think about that as nostalgia. I really don't. I think that there was an incredible and sort of revolutionary movement then that for all sorts of reasons when the epidemic changed, I didn't even get into the role of money and how that changed the epidemic, that it got started and roots were planted, and then it's been kind of been trying to get tamped down ever since. So I think there's something to be learned from that about how we respond today. Someone, we were talking about prevention work, you know, the last thing that I think is effective is you know, going back to those days and the nostalgia. You know, young people don't want to hear about grandpa's service in the war. You know, it just isn't. You know, I always begin my prevention talks by saying, if you get HIV, it's highly unlikely you're going to die from it. You know, you start with kind of the reality of what it is today, and then work from there.
Hi, Sean. Thanks for coming and sharing your story with us and your work with us. The Zero Project's work is amazing, and really glad you could come here and share that with us. You know that HIV criminalization is a big issue in Canada as well, and I wanted to ask you about, it's something we don't yet have here, but you have in the US, which is viral load reporting, mandatory viral load reporting in some states, and I know some public health units in Canada are moving towards that. And we, similar to the US, because of the institutionalization of the AIDS response, we don't really have an advocacy movement around countering that, that happening. I'm wondering if there's any movement, or if there was any reaction or work around mandatory viral load reporting in the US. And also with the increasing of the treatment as prevention regime that's kind of all over the place and came from Canada primarily. Have you had any cases, or have you seen any cases where people have been court ordered to take treatment, or take treatment through court order? I wonder if you could talk about any of that.
Sure. I might sneeze first. I'm not. First, in terms of the viral load reporting, there is a tremendous effort to expand the state surveillance around viral load and around CD4 testing as well. In a number of states, your viral load test is already reported to the state. Your CD4 tests in some states are already reported to the state. In many places, if your viral load goes up, they'll then come find you. Or in Mississippi, some counties in Mississippi get a notice put in your door, they have to come to the health department. Yes, there is all this. New York State, actually, the New York City Health Department a few years ago proposed legislation that they wanted to, when someone in New York City who has HIV, who's on their registry, because it's a required report, when they move somewhere else, maybe they move to Pike County, Pennsylvania, little teeny tiny rural Pike County, Pennsylvania, where I live in a village of 1,100 people. New York City Health Department wanted the legal right to contact the health department where someone else moves to notify them that someone with HIV has moved there. They also wanted the legal right to, actually forget what the disposition of that was. They may have gotten that maybe in some limited way, to keep all the contact tracing information. It used to be that the contact tracing, you know, you'd give your names to your contacts, they would contact them, and then they'd get rid of that data. Now they're keeping a database so they can see names that show up repeatedly and basically, you know, slice and dice to identify people they deem at, you know, particular risk. And they wanted the right to keep that data indefinitely. And I think that I can't swear this, but I think what they got was the right to keep it for 10 years. So there's a huge, I think, move to all that. In terms of treatment as prevention and mandatory treatment, we have de facto mandatory treatment in many circumstances now. A lot of places, you know, the only health care available to you is through your HIV diagnosis. And in many cases, even if it's not explicitly required, you pretty much have to be on treatment in order to access the services provided through that agency. We've had a case just recently in Seattle where someone was required to be on treatment or they would face prosecution. There was a case in Maine a few years ago with a woman who was incarcerated on some fairly minor immigration charge for a few months, and she was about to be released, and the judge found out she was pregnant and she had HIV, and he ordered her held until she gave birth in order to make sure she took her antiretroviral medication. And this was somebody who actually had supportive environment and family and healthcare and everything else, but she was basically continued to be incarcerated solely because she had HIV in order to to impose that mandatory treatment. And I think mandatory is a little bit of the wrong word, because people think of mandatory, or what they call DOT, directly observed therapy, that people with TB often get and so on, because it's more like a subtle coercion. And in my view, withholding information or misrepresenting the science is coercion as well. And this is where I think the patient autonomy is really not being disrespected. And HIV is, because of who gets HIV, the standards are different in that regard. Treatment is prevention. You know, I've been resentful of the phrase because it implies that as a priority for treatment. Now, how about treatment for people who need treatment? It sort of denigrates that role of treatment and all the excitement of treatment of prevention. Oh, let's protect all those negative people, you know, because those of us who already have the virus are less important. And in that regard also, you know, the science is absolutely unresolved about whether or not treatment for people with high CD4 cells will deliver a net benefit or a net harm to that person. Now, everyone with HIV, I think, should be given the option to go on treatment. And if someone with high CD4 cells wants to go on treatment, including if they want just to, you know, to not have to worry about infecting anybody and things like that, fine, that should be their choice. But people with 600 CD4 counts should not be sprinting from the testing clinic to the pharmacy with a prescription because they have been led to believe it is so urgent that they immediately go on treatment, when in fact we don't even know if that treatment will deliver a net benefit or a net harm to them. And so this is a very, you know, kind of contentious issue, and I realize that there are an awful lot of really smart people who think that treatment for every person who is positive will be beneficial. Science hasn't concluded that. And by the way, what other condition do we treat people for when science has not conclusively demonstrated that they will get a net benefit from it? I've been waiting for somebody to suggest one. Sometimes people say, well, vaccinations. Well, the person who's getting the vaccine is getting the benefit of the immunity as well. So, you know, treatment as prevention is driven by a public health imperative, and it's certainly important for public health to reduce transmission. But I don't think it's so important that it should erode a really fundamental human right around patient autonomy. That's actually, in my view, is a violation of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. That's why I don't get invited out much when I say things like that.
Do you think we can make a sort of analogies between HIV stigma and the Truvada horse stigma that we saw presently in the United States?
The Ebola stigma, you said?
Truvada horse stigma, which is a grassroots answer, really quick grassroots answer against this stigma. So is there analogies between them? And do you think also, it's a second question, for 30 years now, do you think there is a kind of internalized serophobia which has been developed between each other? Like being HIV positive now, it's a faith and we're gonna meet stigmatization and it's like that and we have to live with that.
Well, first I'll say that the Truvada whore word, phrase, whatever, I have heard 100 times from people who were very, very pro-PrEP and were, I don't want to say making themselves martyrs or whatever, poor me being attacked. I've heard it 100 times from people who are pro-PrEP for every time I've ever heard it from somebody using it as an epithet. Now, that's not to deny that we have had a persistent, you know, sort of streak or in the community that is, anything but sex positive, right? And that goes back to the earliest days of the epidemic, and it's always there. I don't deny that. I find it, I'm someone who is not as wildly enthusiastic about PrEP as, much of the rest of the world. There's no question it works on an individual basis. If you take it as directed, you're not going to get HIV. But I think its promotion as a widespread public health intervention for populations poses a very real risk of actually increasing HIV rates. I fear that what we're going to see is a few years from now is that that widespread promotion of PrEP is going to reduce HIV incidence in some relatively privileged gay subcultures and lead to an increase in HIV transmission in the communities already least franchised. The Guttmacher Institute is a very prestigious and well-respected advocate for sexual health and reproductive rights issues in the U.S. And they've been publishing some fascinating statistics on unwanted pregnancies in the U.S. That show how unwanted pregnancies amongst white women have dropped pretty consistently, while unwanted pregnancies among women of color have increased. This is over a 10 or 12 year period. So PrEP, you know, now if I was, you know, 25 and having sex the way I had sex when I was 25, which you can read about in my book, I would be taking PrEP. You know, I'm not against people making the choice to take PrEP. Someone who will not or cannot use condoms, I pray that they're on PrEP. You know, I understand that PrEP gives a prevention tool that receptive partners are able to control.
Viral load reporting, mandatory viral load reporting in some states. And I know some public health units in Canada are moving towards that. And we, similar to the US, because of the institutionalization of the AIDS response, we don't really have an advocacy movement around countering that, that happening. I'm wondering if there's any movement or if there was any reaction or work around mandatory viral load reporting in the US. And also with the increasing of the treatment as prevention regime that's kind of all over the place and came from Canada primarily, have you had any cases or have you seen any cases where people have been court ordered to take treatment or
actually transmitted infections facilitate HIV transmission? Truvada is not going to prevent those. And yes, I know people say, oh, well, you can get syphilis and gonorrhea through oral sex and other things. Well, you can. Not nearly as often or as efficiently as through anal sex. Other sexually transmitted infections are transmitted much more efficiently. They're much harder to detect, and they're harder to treat through anal sex than other ways. So what I think has been most unfortunate is that the discourse around PrEP has devolved into this sort of binary. You're pro-PrEP or you're anti-PrEP. You know, you're sex positive or you're sex negative. And I think that has been really irresponsible of a lot of our leadership in the community that has led this. It's like they're trying to win a campaign rather than really have an intelligent exposition of the issues involved. And I find it ironic that, you know, most of my career I've been, you know, accused of being some like sex radical. You know, the word barebacking first appeared in print in PAS, and we printed a whole series of safer barebacking tips in the mid-90s that I was, you know, crucified over. You know, just the most years are horrible, how can you possibly do this? And now, because, you know, I try to have a little more nuanced conversation around PrEP, I'm like, you know, I'm a sex negative, anti-sex Puritan, whatever. Now, having said that, there are, you know, some prominent people who've been opposed to widespread PrEP promotion, like Mike Weinstein at AIDS Healthcare Foundation, who said things that I think are really unhelpful. And, you know, maybe that's where he's coming from. It isn't where I'm coming from.
Hello, thank you. My question is, if you could enlighten us on what is happening these days, what are the laws and how they are changing as far as illegal immigrants or people who are actually applying for status, and how things have changed as far as the laws of their HIV. Because I remember when I used to live
in the States, I couldn't do anything, and I had to find different courses. I'm just wondering, with the new bills and everything. Thank you. Right.
Well, the travel ban has been lifted. It doesn't mean a person still can't have difficulties at the border. Beyond that, I'm not well enough informed. You know, there's been so much happening with our INS, the Immigration Naturalization, around all sorts of things and all the border stuff and everything, that it wouldn't surprise me if there have been changes, and there have probably been some that have been good, but there may well be some that are bad. I just am not well enough informed to be able to tell you. I do know now. However, this is exactly, so I was working on this last week, this new network this conference we had this summer, there were two people there who were one is, I think, still presently undocumented, and the other person that had been undocumented is now illegal as a work permit. And we've now got a little nucleus to try and put together a group of immigrants to work, to identify the issues that need that voice. And I'm sure that will be on their agenda. And be a priority for them, which it isn't for any other organization or effort or endeavor out there that I know of.
I'll just borrow this for a second. We don't actually have time for one, but I wanted to ask if anyone from the course wanted to ask a question. I don't think anyone from the actual course has gotten a chance to ask one yet. You don't have to out yourself as being in the course either. We can just take one more question. I know it could be dangerous to do so. Everyone will be watching what you're doing after the lecture. I really want to go to your workshop tomorrow. I'm really inspired by everything that you've talked about. I'm sure that there's a whole bunch more questions that people will want to ask you, and that you flashed your Gmail address to us at the end of the film. That was because...
That's why I'm very responsive by email. I'm very happy to respond.
I think this evening could have gone on a lot longer, and the great thing about the lecture series this year is that we can trace these interconnections from one lecture to another, and you got to us before Rob Epstein did, which is our next lecture on January 15th, same time and place is the next lecture in the lecture series. I can only think of thanking the volunteers who are here, who greeted everybody and who were at the door, the interns from the HIV lecture series, yes, and everybody who's there. Please go see Conrad at the back, who's selling copies of Body Counts, which Sean is hopefully going to autograph for me first and then for the rest of you after. And of course, Tom and Karen and Vivian and Ian are doing a demo.
And Johnny's, I don't know if Johnny's here, but the poster is wonderful.
Yeah, way to go on the poster. I don't think I'm forgetting to thank anybody else other than, of course, Brian Gabriel. Thank you for being there from the journalism department for your introduction. We're doing a demo. The lecture series needs money like a Truvada whore needs a hashtag. So we need to provide to the lecture series. Yes, Greg, of course, the TAs, Greg and Florence, yeah, the co-instructors, I'm getting it all wrong. Anyway, you do things to the children and they appreciate it. So the other thing is, a major important thing, Monday happens to be World AIDS Day, I wish you could stay, we're doing an anti-austerity demo for which there's flyers being handed out, that's at the Cerro Santiago Blood Union, those are everywhere, that's coming up Monday, banner making, mask making, a procession, and a vigil all against austerity. I wish you a wonderful evening, we'll see you in January, thank you, Sean Stewart. Go and see Ian if you want to get more of this information from Sean Stewart tomorrow.